I'm a Wolof speaker and a French speaker, and I speak English once in a while. So I apologize for my English. So it is with an immense pride that I did this lecture to celebrate with you the Golden Jubilee of the African, of the Institute of African Studies, which was inaugurated by President Nkrumah almost to the day. So all my sincerest thanks go to friends and colleagues who have bestowed this singular honor on me. Mais je tiens à remercier particulièrement l'ambassade de France et ses services culturels pour avoir pris totalement en charge ma participation à cet événement et avoir, je vous en remercie énormément, facilité la traduction de mon texte. Merci infiniment. Merci également aux traducteurs, because they did an excellent job. And whatever mistake, bear in mind, because I tried to cut into my paper. So thank you very everyone for being here. The next time I will invite the president to have this big, big room filled. Or you put me in a smaller room when I would feel more comfortable. Otherwise, I am highly positioned. So to come down is going to be difficult in the next hour. But through the establishment of this institution, the University of Ghana signaled in the early 60s, when I was a student, a remarkable epistemology break from the academic tradition of African universities we inherited. Decolonizing science and academia, Africanizing curricula were long intellectual and political processes. In his speech during the inauguration of the Institute, President Nkrumah reminded us about education as a priority challenge, a challenge which comforts us as members of universities. The second challenge I read and it placed before us was to build a dynamic society. A dynamic society where cultures change, and change because we want our society to change. And finally, the third challenge was to establish a society in which there would be equal opportunities for all people or for men and women. So how have we fared with those challenges? When I was invited a few months ago to speak at this event, I naturally referred to some of my concerns, as a researcher, but also as an activist. During part of my career and my life around women's studies, I have been challenged by the complex relations between religion, culture, and politics, and the impact on women's position within society, their responsibilities and rights, as well as on gender relations. This complexity was prevalent in my research on African women issues, in research I completed with the Senegal Ministry of Women's Affairs over 2 decades. As a member of DAWN, a network of feminists from South Africa, Asia, Latin America, and the Caribbean, we often carried comparative debates about Christianity, Hinduism, and Islam, intertwined with local cultures and politics. The intricacy became even more salient since, after I retired from academia and started coordinating the International Solidarity Network of Women Living Under Muslim Laws that brings together networkers from Asia, Africa, and the Middle East, from Muslim communities in Europe, the US, and Canada. So we discussed about the impact of laws said to be derived from Islam on women's status and life. 2 years ago, in June 2011, at the invitation of the Kodesia Gender Institute, I proposed a debate on fundamentalisms based on linkages between culture, religion, and politics, which was then and is still of utmost relevance in the North and West Africa, to mention just this region in the world where I live in. It is needless to recall the Arab Spring and the tragedy in Mali. In the year 2011 to 2013, the impact on communities, particularly women, were at the center of my interest between 2010 and 2013, as I said. The political situation, as my mind, changed dramatically in this northern and southern region of the African continent, bringing to the fore the complex nature of the relationships between the state as a political institution, culture as identity reference, and religion as both institution and reference of which one is called to respect a holy system of beliefs. We have been witnessing how those relationships get more and more complex in our contemporary context, as both culture and religion become strongly political and often show fundamentalist and static orientation as part of religious and cultural identities. Those relations are impacting on African women's rights and citizenship. So this is what I would like to discuss, how and why. About 10 years ago, at the outset of the new millennium, Codestria invited us as African scholars to rethink development. Professor Samir Amin, in his keynote speech, reminded us about the challenges of neoliberal policies and their impact on the world economy at the global level. He also discussed the unsustainability of local economies already affected by about 2 decades of structural adjustment policies. Invited as a keynote speaker at the same meeting about rethinking development if gender mattered, I agreed that the economic order imposed on third world societies and economies has never been so dominated by market forces, and that the political order weighed heavily on the state and on our systems of governance, corrupting relations between the state and the citizens. Facing the changes and new challenges imposed by globalization, one of my questions was, do we still have the freedom, the ambition, the dream, and the capacity of an African development generated from our various experiences, minds, ethics, when poverty alleviation policies become a sort of state business? Vivian Taylor from South Africa, editor of a Dawn book called Marketization of Governance, published in 2000, looking at the global situation of the late 90s, noted that, and I quote, the global political economy, the continuance of neoliberal macroeconomic policies, and the rise of fundamentalisms and other forms of patriarchal backlash emerged in the context of identity politics. So why do we question the impact of those issues on women, on their rights as citizens? I still remind that in 2001, at the International Conference on Civil Society, the UN Plus Five and Beyond in Australia, Gita Sen, an Indian economist, and Benny Madunagu, a Nigerian scientist, gave a clear picture of the complexity of the situation. They wrote, and I quote, on the one side, there are the poorly regulated processes of globalization, the new form of a free market juggernaut, driven by deep and growing inequalities of wealth and income, in which rising numbers of impoverished people, especially women, are being marginalized from access to secure livelihoods. On the other side, there is a strengthening of national, religion-based, ethnic, or other identities in which the assertion of traditional gender roles and system of authority and control is central. The challenge for women is how to assert the need for both economic and gender justice in an increasingly globalized and fundamentalist world. End of quote. So we may analyze the characteristic of the globalization by a high-tech neoliberal economy, globalization of stock market speculation, and massive transfer of funds, of control of resources, of production, of both phenomenal growth and unequal poverty. We must identify within the inequalities which it engenders the root and deeper motives for the multiple economic and political violence visited on societies and individuals, not only in Africa, but almost worldwide. I live in Europe and I've seen the impact of globalization on French societies, British societies, US societies I've been traveling through. We are witnessing the worsening of the violation of the rights of large portions of the world population, particularly of women, in the economic, political, and cultural domains, due especially to the decline of the welfare state and its lapse to mercantilism, as recalled by Vivian Taylor in the book I mentioned. Trade agreements signed within the framework of neoliberal policies and privatization have been denounced as systems infringing on international human rights conventions, particularly the economic rights of workers. The treatment of public utilities as commodities has increased the burden of maintaining families on women, particularly in the upkeep of the home, education, health, and the feminization of poverty. So what needs to be pointed out here is that the global neo-political system is not only an economic system, it is also political and social cultural. It is corollary in the West of a neoconservatism which conveys equally conservative, conformist, and backward religious and cultural values as those the West claims to fight against in Muslim cultures and politics. But we have to admit that conservatives on both sides may even become allies based on geopolitical and economic interests. The groups which hold these ideologies try to promote values opposed to the current social transformation in the name of God, in the name of Christian values. They do not allow any critical new reading of the original text, as would do most conservative Muslim groups, as Wahhabis, Salafis, or Taliban groups, just to name a few you daily hear about in the world media. So we face resurgence of forces which are both political and social religious. They are mostly political far-right groups. This resurgence is worldwide and is at the heart of our discussions. My examples will be mostly drawn from African Muslim societies, for they have been the focus of my academic and activist reflections. It is not easy to denounce the various religious and cultural fundamentalisms when you are Muslim and African, specifically when you are women. Religion and culture bear a mark of identity which was used by communities in firstly asserting themselves, as well as they used it in their struggle against a colonial, then post-colonial order. To call into question religion or culture, or religion and culture, especially when religion and culture are so deeply intertwined, is perceived as departing from a nationalist commitment for actions against a dominant Western order, against modernity perceived as Western. The debate about modernity, modernism, postmodernism, postcolonial, you name it, is still recurrent. So how does the collusion between religion, culture, and politics impact on African women's rights and citizenship? Religion, culture, and politics produce an action so interwoven and so mixed up in the daily realities of peoples and of women that it is extremely difficult to disentangle them, to establish and make out the various sources of influence. They often merge and or confront each other at the local, national, as well as international levels. Religion and culture are core elements of the various processes of transformation and restructuring today's social and political powers in the world and in Africa. In countries that claim to be secular, the religious, considered as a dimension of the private life, extend more and more into the public and in politics. In fact, it never left the political sphere, even when relegated to the private. Furthermore, new relationships between religion and politics have taken on a new profile with the increasing radicalization of religious groups, from Christianity to Islam, from Judaism to Hinduism, just to name those few. So when one looks at most of the issues women have been raising for the past 30, 40 years, particularly during the two United Nations Women's Decade, 1975 to 1995, the focus is clearly about their position within the family, their sexual and reproductive health and rights, their access to education, training and employment, at the basis of their economic empowerment, and their political rights as citizenship. But regarding those rights, women face critical challenges from religion and culture and politics, even if we have to note that the state has been in many cases in advance on religion and culture. So religion and culture might disagree or bargain with politics. I think of the various forms of political Islam, political Christianity. We won't have the time to use this here, maybe later in the global discussion. But in connection with women's bodies, they often agree, and I think too often. Moreover, and this is common in my part of Africa, many people consider issues related to women's sexual and reproductive health and rights as westernized, as copied from Western feminism and feminist concepts, and consequently, where I've dismissed most women's claims about their bodies. Various ideologies, and I think of ideologies as systems of ideas, and for me, religion and culture are part of the system of ideas. Those various ideologies are very influential on the issues. The church and the mosque are in constant debate with the state with regard to women's bodies. When I speak here about Islam and the mosque, I mainly refer not to Islam as a religion, but I refer to Muslim cultures, the various one in which Islam is embedded and which shape Muslim identities. Our experience as women living under Muslim laws as a global network within the Muslim world, that experience showed that we certainly stay in the same region and its grounding principles, but we have many different experiences, behavior, and practices. The creation of Muslimness is, in general, present a challenge to the construction of a Muslim woman. What is a Muslim woman? how do we identify ourselves? Abdullah Nahim, a well-known professor of law in Sudan, points out, and I quote, the principle of Muslim laws called Sharia laws, are always derived from a human interpretation of the Holy Book, the Quran, and the Sunnah, which is the teaching and the sayings of the Prophet Muhammad. They are based on the understanding of human beings and what they want to comply with, within their own specific historic context. End of quote. So Muslim cultural patterns show a wide spectrum of differences from Saudi Arabia to Senegal, from Pakistan to Turkey. So the Ummah as a unifying word is still critical. So why is the issue of religion still so important today? It is not because of the faith and the moral values religion conveys that any one of us can freely choose for or choose against, but rather the political status that religious institutions fight for. And it's not only in Muslim countries. Religion features in politics worldwide. Within the European Union, some member states are still demanding that Christianity be regarded as a constitutional dimension of the European identity, while they express a strong resistance to the entrance of Turkey in the European Union as a Muslim state member. Barack Obama, the President of the United States, has been facing conservative opponents, including members of the Tea Party. And I want to discuss about the vote of the budget a few days ago. Members of Christian churches have played an increasing role in the management of political crises in Central Africa. I think of the Republic of Congo Brazzaville in the last political crisis. I think of the Democratic Republic of Congo. And all over Africa, the presence and influence of evangelical churches is obvious, and they are gaining more and more influence in politics. So the influence of Islam on politics is also a reality in Africa. In recent history, some Muslim states of northern Nigeria have used religion as a political tool. In 2002, for instance, some northern Nigerian states enforced Sharia laws in all courts, whatever the plaintiffs face. Such a decision was illegal. It was ruled unconstitutional by the federal government in Abuja. Other country states as Mauritania or Sudan became Islamic republics, while Islam is a state religion in most, if not all, North African states. So all those phenomena are significant ways in which religion and politics are intertwined on the continent and show that religion has never been absent from political arena, even when relegated to the private sphere. Furthermore, they show how the new profile of relationships between religion and politics with the rising radicalization of religious groups. Their main goals are to lead and transform society with religious norms which they really find themselves have been constructed. The Islamization of political and judicial institutions in Muslim countries, for example, Egypt, Mauritania, Sudan, Morocco, help to reject some institutions and rules imposed by former colonizers and from the international arena, mostly UN conventions on human rights. Secularism was interpreted as a symbol of foreign modernity. And lately, in some Muslim countries or countries with a Muslim majority, provisions of the penal code, family laws, or personal status were reviewed based on Sharia, as happened in 2009 in Mali. In 2009, the judges that made a decision in Mali between the north and the south decided that the northern part would be ruled by Sharia, while Mali was a republic, was a secular state. And the state in the south always claimed, and as it never did before, that there was sukkah, that laïcité was the basic principle of the state. In Mali, before the jihadists invaded the northern part, the country was secular. The Islamist fighters, and I quote and I cite the National Movement for Liberation of Azawad, MNLA, Ansaruddin, Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, the Movement for Oneness and Jihad in West Africa, just to name a few of them. I won't know the name Boko Haram because I've been told to be there, but nobody really got the proof. They sought to promote Sharia as a fundamental law. Also, as I said, the country was secular and claimed it. The Al-Shabaab militants were part of Islamic Court Union, which ruled Somalia in 2006, and they are still active. The remaking of constitutions in North Africa after the Arab Spring is also problematic. Will Sharia continue to be the source of the constitution and other laws? Will the Tunisian parliament, dominated by Ennahda, the new ruling party, inscribe the new constitution that men and women are complementary and not equal before law, as written in the President Bourguiba's constitution at independence? This is a question. In the same way, like religion, culture, and I mean here by culture, social patterns, ethnicity, and religious patterns of culture, because they are really combined, have been used as a form of identity and as a tool for reshaping relations within society. Within culture, there is a rampant daily fundamentalism which is no doubt equally offensive. It is a very ordinary fundamentalism or radicalism of ordinary people whose thinking, daily attitudes and behavior have an impact even more insidious on people's lives and in particular on the life of women. It is judgment on clothing, on public and private conduct, which is encountering disapproval and condemnation. It includes the obligation for individuals to fast or to break the fast, or at least not to eat in public at the time of Ramadan. It's the obligation to pray in a very ostentatious manners in public. It includes the obligation for women to wear the veil, considered as a symbol of feminine Muslimness, and the debate in many countries in Africa, Muslim and not Muslim, and many countries all over the world. I live partially in France, and there was a debate about a law against banning the scarf. But at the same time, the Islamic scarf was already mandatory in Muslim northern Nigeria from 2003. It became mandatory in northern Mali with the Jihadist movement. Women were whipped for not wearing it. And in many parts of the Western Sahel, Wahhabi communities imposed to women to wear the full veil, as seen in the streets of Dakar, Bamako or Conakry. So, and more women and young girls, and even my students, wear the Islamic scarf on campus and in the streets of our cities. So refusal to keep to those imposed codes of conduct could be a source of conflict and violence. The ban on women wearing trousers or any Western clothes in President Mobutu's Zaire, informed the same fundamentalist culture order at that time. In recent years, some Nigerian churches decided to ban the wearing of trousers in church. In the same vein, the Nigerian government proposed a bill of indecent dressing for all citizens, on the claim that, and I quote, indecent dressing among Nigerians has continued to promote all manners of vices in the society. And I, end of quote. The bill was to address issues of indecency and immorality for the preservation of cultural norms and values. So I agree with the Nigerian Feminist Forum members when they responded as follows, and I quote, the chairperson of such an important committee in the Senate is trivializing women's concerns and issues by laying emphasis on dress code while ignoring critical and life-threatening issues affecting women which need urgent and immediate attention. So the revival of religious and cultural values is certainly interfering with the making of laws and policies and contributing to the backlash against the new rules women gain on the international arena, mainly at the level of the United Nations. As the feminist critique points out, in the last 20 years, the control of human body has become more than ever a political project that serves the fundamentalists, whatever religion. Several issues have been at stake in their struggle for women's rights over their bodies and consequently on health. Female genital mutilations are pre-Islamic, but today justified as signs of purity and cleanness in Muslim societies who perpetuate these practices. An international conference, should I remember, on FGM started a couple of days ago on October 21st in Rome. There is a combination of religious and cultural practices which often, if not all the time, oppress women. Early and forced marriage to protect girls' virginity. Also, in most countries, the age of marriage is about 10 or 15 years. Virginity was recommended and virginity tests were carried out in many countries as part of HIV/AIDS programs. Maternal mortality. The figures are just growing. But those figures are reinforced by the ideology of motherhood. Women in Africa are celebrated as motherhood. But having children at any cost of health, time in education, and work is very problematic. Repudiation instead of divorce is still enforced in many courts of religious as well as secular states. It is repudiation within the family. Even if in court, you can apply for a divorce. The impunity of rape is prevalent in many Muslim societies because the victims need to have four male witnesses of a rape. And the family can be compensated when the rapist agrees to marry the victim. In Senegal, for instance, in Morocco, many cases were reported. And a few months ago, a Moroccan girl who was married to a rapist killed herself. So a law is in discussion. I don't know if it was passed in the Moroccan parliament to discuss about the case. WWML supported in 2009 and 2010 a campaign to reform rape laws in Sudan. But the campaign stopped when the president was convicted by the International Penal Court. But let's also remember that rape was a war weapon in Sierra Leone, Liberia, Congo Brotherhood conflicts, and continues to be prevalent in the Democratic Republic of Congo. It is also an increasing worrying trend in South Africa, and of course all over the world. An equal inheritance between men and women still exists and affects women access to resources. Even gender parity is at stake and is questioned from a religious perspective. So if I give all those examples, because those examples give the issues that we are faced with as citizens in our country. Because part of our control of our body is part of our citizenship. So reconfiguring the family laws with religious principles often means reinforcing gender equality and control over women's body. It is difficult not to see and question the patriarchal nature of the contemporary African state. Although the state since independence progressively responded to landscapes of rights well ahead of society, its institution still set standards to legitimize women's inferiority as a cultural and religious norm. Civil law, just like religious concepts, still maintain the man as the head of the family, regardless of the man's responsibilities. Women still have to nibble their way in politics, having been only tolerated here. Gender parity is still at stake. Rwanda has 56% of members of parliament, Senegal 42%. But how many female parliamentarians do we have in other African countries? And despite claims of equality in political discourses, states are still reluctant to enforce law, including international conventions they signed and ratified that could help promote and strengthen women's rights. Muslim population, whether fundamentalist or moderate, have always insisted on the respect of Islamic values in managing gender relations within the family. Niger and Chad don't yet have a secular family code because of their attachment to Sharia. The large majority of leaders in Muslim countries continue to elaborate and revise their family laws based on their interpretation of Sharia while bringing their family code, while bringing several reforms of modern law. There is always the claim of not hurting the religious texts and their precepts. So, and I'm about to conclude, there's the main issue that is raised is what about secularism? Because the claim that we have is to have really separation between religion and politics, between religion and the making of the law. And in many of our countries that claim to be secular, the making of family laws still depend upon religious texts. So secularism raised the question of the nature of relations between political and religious authority. The definitions vary according to protagonists. Could secularism be only the separation between religion and the state as pertained in France? Other patterns still exist, but secularism has been mainly praised or contested as the basis principle of modernity and is presumed to play an essential role in debates on democracy as a universal model of society. And this can be seen when one analyzes all the controversies between some civil society organizations on the end and the states and religious authorities on the other end, concerning sensitive issues like family planning, contraception, abortion, ways of preventing AIDS, sexual freedom, bodily integrity, bioethical subjects like euthanasia, medically assisted conception, genetic testing, and I even don't touch on sexual orientation. All those questions pose moral challenges to people's identity and underline the reciprocal influence of questions about identity and religion. There is much criticism of Islam as being incompatible with secularist rule, and this is a question that we have to face. So in conclusion, it seems to go very brief, my conclusion. It is very critical to use a human rights approach for global citizens and for women to be involved in decisions and policy that concern their body, economic, and political rights. We cannot let patriarchal organizations continue to decide for human rights as citizens with the view of preserving religion and culture. At the international level, most African states sign and ratify international documents on human rights. They signed and ratified the protocol of the African Charter on Human Rights, Human and People's Rights, and the Rights of Women in Africa. They integrated plans of ICPDs, human rights in Vienna, and all sorts of international conventions, like the Women Protocols in Beijing, at the level of national policies. But this is in theory. It is still very difficult to enforce most international conventions and bring gender justice in the law. And this is a challenge, one of the major challenges we are facing this. Thank you. Sorry if I've been long.